Hello, my name is Łukasz Hawryłko. I'm working at Intel as secure engineer. On a daily basis, I'm developing and also an architecture of TBOOT project, which is an OS loader for Linux that allows to use Intel TXT technology under Linux operating systems. In this presentation, I want to share with you my concept of integrating UEFI Secure Boot support for the TBOOT, because current TBOOT version does not allow to use UEFI Secure Boot together with TBOOT. Basically, when you are trying to launch TBOOT when UEFI Secure Boot is enabled, it is just impossible. UEFI Secure Boot will not allow you to do that. Here is the agenda for today's presentation. So first we'll go through briefly what is UEFI Secure Boot, what is Intel TXT, what's the differences between these two technologies. Then we'll go to description of TBOOT, the internal architecture, how it is built, what TBOOT does. Then I will tell you in details why it's impossible to use TBOOT when Secure Boot is enabled. And then I will share with you my proposed solution, how this can be fixed. Also, at the end, we will discuss the benefits and limitations of my proposed solution. So UEFI Secure Boot is platform-independent technology. It should be available on any platforms that are UEFI capable. This is a static root of trust technology. That means that root of trust needs to be established at the beginning of the platform launch, and then it should be maintained up to OS level. That means we have to verify each component that is between the platform launch and the OS, and all of these components need to be trusted, need to be inside TCB. That leads to some potential problems, because the bigger TCB, the probability of some vulnerability is higher. That's why, for example, when we recently the researchers discovered a boot hole in grub, that means that grub may skip the secure boot verification process. That means that all secure boot process for Linux operating system is not trusted, because one of the components that are in this boot process is have vulnerabilities. Also, it's worth to mention that UEFI maintains database DBDBX that contains list of allowed and disallowed keys that can be used to sign each of components during the boot that are launched during the boot process. Problem here is that Microsoft owns the database, so only keys accepted by Microsoft can be added to that database. That leads to some difficulties in open source community to use Secure Boot, because it's not very easy task to ship system with keys outside of Microsoft. That's why when Linux is used, there is also another component called Shim that is a preloader for grub. It maintains its own database, key database, MOK, and Shim is signed by Microsoft key. Shim is a very simple application. Its main role is just to run next loader, but because of the simplicity, it was possible to get signed by Microsoft, and then it can be verified in any UEFI platform that is shipped with Microsoft keys. As Shim maintains its own database, it's possible for other OS vendors to add its own keys to Shim's database or embed that keys in Shim build. So other Linux systems can be verified by Shim. That's why in Linux UEFI boot process there is another component in the boot flow that is required, because, as I said, the problem with adding OS vendor's key to UEFI database. But the whole general idea for the secure boot is still the same. So as I said, Microsoft owns key in DBDBX, and it's very difficult to get GRUB or Linux kernel signed by Microsoft. That's why Shim was created. It's very simple application. It's signed by Microsoft. It maintains its own key database, and this key database can be used to verify the next components after the shim is loaded, the next component signatures. And this database MOK may have OS vendors keys, and also end users can add its own keys to the database. And what's important fact is that Shim also exposes a Shimlock protocol that can be used by components launched after the Shim to verify signature. The Shimlock component, the Shimlock protocol, is added to boot services, and it behaves like standard UEFI secure boot verification mechanism. It can be used instead of it. But the difference is, of course, is that it verifies the signature against MOK, not the DBDBX. In Intel TXT, the flow is a little bit different. So Intel TXT is DRTN solution. That's why the root of trust can be established during the boot process, not at the beginning. That means that all the components before root of trust is established are not required to be trusted. And speaking about the boot hole process does not affect the boot hole vulnerability, does not affect Intel TXT, because GRUB is not in the Intel TXT TCB. As you can see here, there is another application that is between GRUB and Linux. It is called TBOOT. TBOOT is split into two parts, the first part called pre-MLE and the second part called MLE. Pre-MLE part is also not trusted, it's also not in TCB for Intel TXT. The main role for pre-MLE part of TBOOT is to prepare environment, prepare platform for launching TXT. Pre-MLE part of TBOOT is verifying its platform is TXT capable, if configuration, bus configuration is properly set. Also, it loads its init, which is a binary blob for the TXT, and after everything is set up, it executes special CPU instruction, which is in SMX instruction set for Intel CPUs, called getsecenter, and from this point, microcode is establishing a root of trust. And after the root of trust is established, it verifies the signature of a SINIT. SINIT, as I said, is a binary blob that is a part of Intel TXT. It is signed by Intel's key, and that's why UCOT, Intel CPU UCOT, can verify if a SINIT is unmodified and it's a trusted binary file. SINIT does its own verification of platform configuration, checks if everything is configured in trusted way. If for example, MLE part of TBOOT is inside DMA protected region, and also applies policy that can be provided to SINIT in TPM. After all its job, the last thing that the SINIT does is to measure and execute the MLE part of TBOOT. So basically, a SINIT is jumping back to TBOOT, but now we are in the MLE part of TBOOT, and this part is trusted. So we are inside measured environment, we are inside trusted environment, and from this point, TBOOT is considered as a trusted binary. In ML part, TBOOT, the most important job that TBOOT has to do is to measure and execute Linux kernel. So it also can compute the hashes of initrd, and also there's a possibility to provide policy to TBOOT to verify if measurements are the same as expected. But it's not required. TBOOT can just extend TPM PCRs with measurements and then continue to boot Linux. So TBOOT is an open source implementation of MLE component for Intel TXT. It prepares a system for entering measured environment. After that, in MLE part, it measures and verifies Linux kernel and initrd. And also it installs hook. It installs a hook in Linux kernel. So when Linux kernel is going to shut down process, it will not call the ACPI call to turn off the platform, but instead go jump to TBOOT shutdown entry, so TBOOT can properly turn down all the TXT environment, wipe the TPM PCRs, and then wipe the memory, and then shut down the platform. So when we are trying to combine UEFI Secure Boot and TBOOT, the problem that we achieved is that TBOOT can't be signed like a normal UEFI application. That's why when grub is trying to load TBOOT, it will fail because it can't verify TBOOT signature, and in UEFI Secure Boot the verification is a mandatory step. That's the main reason why we can't use TBOOT when Secure Boot is enabled. There are also a few other things that need to be taken into consideration. First thing is that TBOOT requires to use multi-boot 2 protocol, that is a protocol defined by grub. That means that TBOOT can't be run without grub. Grub is also a mandatory step in the boot process when we want to use TBOOT. As I said, TBOOT is a binary that can be signed. It's 32-bit ELF binary, so it can be signed using the signing mechanism from UEFI. And also, which is important, TBOOT is not aware of UEFI services. So it can use services, it can verify Linux kernel using UEFI Secure Boot, because it's also inside the UEFI services. This is not possible when using TBOOT. So first thing from the list in the previous slide was multi-boot 2. That's not a big problem, because recent grub versions allow to verify signature of multi-boot 2 kernels. It's already working. However, still the problem is that binary should be in PE format, because only PE format binary allows to add signature to the file. Grub uses shimlock protocol, which I mentioned before when I was talking about shim to verify this signature. That's not a problem. That's even better, because then we can add our key to the MOK database. It's not required to ask Microsoft for to signing TBOOT binary. Now let's look how grub loads TBOOT. So basically, TBOOT binary consists of few sections before the actual code. The first thing is ELF header, which is a mandatory part of ELF binary. In ELF header, we have information about entry point, about the size of binary, about the sections in the binary, and where the section should be loaded in the memory. Also, there is a multi-boot 2 header, because as I said, multi-boot 2 is a mandatory protocol for TBOOT. Multi-boot 2 header has some information to grub. For example, if FE services should be shut down before launching TBOOT or not. There are also some information about the size of the binary to be loaded. Then we have an entry point, which is a standard 32-bit entry point, and then after that there is a continuation with code and data sections. So what is worth mentioning here is that multi-boot to header can also have information about entry point and size of a binary, and also a target memory when the binary should be loaded. That means that all the information required for grub to load and run TBOOT binary can be stored inside multi-boot to header. What is more important is that this information has higher priority than information from the ELF file. So if we add a tags to multi-boot to an address tag and an entry tag, grub will take these values instead of values from ELF header to load and run TBOOT. That means that in this scenario, ELF header is not necessary and can be just deleted or can be removed. So if ELF header can be removed, we can replace it with PE header. That's not a problem, because TBOOT will still, grub will still have information about where TBOOT should be loaded and what's the entry point address from multi-boot header. So adding here a PE header does not affect in the boot process. However, it allows signing tool and verification tool to sign and verify a signature of that binary. This is good, because that's what we want to achieve. The problem here is that as most of the UEFI platforms are 64-bit, the information about binary in the PE header should also indicate that TBOOT is a 64-bit application. I have tried to configure PE header as 32-bit, which is a true for the TBOOT. However, the verification mechanism in the boot process will interrupt the verification process, because it will detect the mismatch between platform, the current platform, and the binary. That's why PE header should indicate that TBOOT is 64-bit application, and then everything works. However, the problem here is that if somebody wants to run this PE binary directly from the UEFI shell, it will get crashed, because the PE header will indicate that binary is 64-bit, and then entry point is 32-bit. That will not work, of course. That's why I have created another entry point for TBOOT, which is a 64-bit short snippet of a code that only prints an information that this binary is required to be run with multi-boot 2, and you can't just run it from the EFI shell. The problem with PE header is that normally when you are building the PE binary, the PE application, this header is generated automatically by the compiler. Here in this case it's impossible. That's why I have to define it manually in the code, using it's based on the patch posted to Zen by Daniel Kipper few years ago. It just manually creates all the mandatory fields and put it in the correct place to build the whole PE header. There's also a section table inside PE header just to cover all the TBOOT binary. It's required for the signing and verification application to sign whole binary, not only the header part. So the section table is built properly. As I said, it indicates that this is 64-bit application. And if you are trying to run TBOOT using this, if you are trying to run TBOOT from the directly from the UEFI shell, you will get just the message that this binary requires to be run with multi-boot 2. So here are the results. We have shim that is verifying to execute grub. Then grub is verifying to execute tboot binary. Tboot now can be signed because it's in PE format. Tboot works like before, so it executes getsecs enter, then we are jumping to SINIT, and SINIT is jumping back to MLE part of tboot. From this point we are inside trusted environment for TXT, and also we are in trusted environment provided by secure boot, because the tboot binary was signature was verified by grub. However, as I said, tboot does not allow to does not aware of UEFI services. That's why it can't verify Linux signature. There's also another problem here. As init requires to call exit boot services before launching it. So even if tboot can access EFI services from this point in MLE part, it will be impossible because exit boot services will be run before, and all boot services will not be available here. That's why from this point we are finishing the secure boot chain, and only we are measuring it and executing Linux in TXT manner. It's still better than before, because now it is possible to enable secure boot at run TXT. However, there are some missing points, because our goal is to provide end-to-end trusted chain by in new UEFI secure boot, and now we are breaking it on the tboot application. So how can we verify Linux kernel signature when we are using tboot? We know that kernel signature can be verified using FE shimmer protocol. Grub can may keep boot services available when loading multi-boot kernel. However, the problem is still that, as I said, tboot is not aware of FE services at all. The second problem is that FE services are mostly 64-bit, because on most modern platform FE is a 64-bit service. And tboot is 32-bit application, so we know that it's impossible to combine these two things. But as we know, we can add a 64-bit entry to tboot like we did before, and this entry can verify Linux kernel with shimlock protocol, which is exposed by shim. Then it can call exit boot services, because this is required for SINIT, and we can't do that from 32-bit tboot part. And then it can switch CPU to 32-bit protected mode, and then jump to standard 32-bit entry. This is the idea. But this idea requires some more changes in structure of tboot binary. So here is the final structure. So we have PE header like before, we have multi-boot 2 header like before. However, now multi-boot 2 entry tag does not point to 32-bit entry like before, but it points to 64-bit entry. Also, there is a special tag in multi-boot 2 header that instructs grub to not call exit boot services before launching tboot. That allows us to access FE boot services from the 64-bit entry point in tboot. In 64-bit entry, we can use shimlock protocol to verify Linux kernel, then we can call exit boot services and jump to 32-bit entry, switch to 32-bit protected mode, switch CPU to 32-bit protected mode, and then jump to 32-bit entry, standard entry point for tboot. Then we would continue executing like before, there's no differences. So here is the final result. We have secure boot enabled, so shim is verifying grub's signature, Also, Stream installs its Streamlock protocol to FE boot, to boot services. Then Grub is loading TBOOT using multi-boot protocol, because, but as I said, multi-boot to allows to verify secure boot signature. So first TBOOT verifies the signature, then launches TBOOT using information from multi-boot to header. So it jumps to 64 entry point of TBOOT. And then TBOOT from this primary part, because this 64-bit and 64-bit entry point will be inside primary part. This entry point will verify, only verify Linux signature, nothing more. And then it will switch to 32-bit, continue the execution of TBOOT like before. Then TBOOT will, like before, go to SCINIT. SCINIT will establish the trusted environment for Intel TXT. And then SCINIT will jump back to MLE part of TBOOT. From this point, everything is launched like in normal flow. So TBOOT is measuring and extended PCRs with measurements of Linux kernel and initRD, and then executing Linux kernel. As I said before, Linux kernel signature is verified before in pre-MLE part by 64-bit entry in TBOOT, and also so Linux is trusted by TXT because its measurements are extended to TPM PCRs. So now we have the situation where trusted chain for secure boot is keep from the beginning up to the OS, and also Intel TXT is used as a secondary technology that give us a more security during the boot process. Okay, so let's talk about benefits and limitations. So the most obvious benefits that we are adding another layer of verification. Also, Secure Boot allows to verify components that are not covered by TXT, because as I said, Grub and everything before Grub, so BIOS and any other preloader before Grub like Shim, is not inside Intel TXT. TCB is not verified by Intel TXT. Also, some customers may have a requirement to have Secure Boot enabled and also want to use Intel TXT as another level of verification. I've got I have some discussion with a few customers, and indeed the problem that if they can't use Intel TXT, even they won't, because that requires turn off the secure boot. The biggest problem here is that boot services need to be terminated before GetSecOS enter. That means that Linux kernel does not have access to boot services. I don't see any solution for that, because accessing boot services inside from the component that is inside Intel TXT TCB means that Intel TXT TCB should be expanded to UEFI. That means that the primary benefit of using Intel TXT, that its TCB is very small, and only few components, the few mandatory components are inside this TCB. This benefit is not valid if you want to use boot services from Linux kernel. So that's the biggest limitation, and we just have to live with it. There is no possibility to do any workaround for that. So the current development status is that I have prepared a POC with all these changes that I have described in this presentation. The POC is submitted to the repository, to the upstream repository of TBOOT on the SourceForge. It is put to branch 2.x, because the overall idea is to bump version of TBOOT, current latest version is 1.9.12, and the version that supports UEFI Secure Boot will begin with 2. So that's why the branches, I have created another branch for that. I'm waiting for the feedback from community about the opinion, about the, if this solution is useful for them, if maybe something is missing, and if I've got if I collect a feedback, also if when this solution goes to goes to validation. After that, I will merge it into default branch and then bump the whole TBOOT version to 2.0.0. Thank you for listening for this presentation. I'm open to answer you any questions. Also, if there are some other thoughts after this summit, please ask me using the TBOOT mailing list. I'm active there, so if there are some thoughts, some ideas, please send just an email to that mailing list. Thank you.